Today's episode of the Cedric Phillips podcast is brought to you by the one and only Stainerson on Magic Online. That, my friends, is one Tommy Ashton, a longtime friend, travel buddy for many a pro tour, and also someone I chat with about wrestling and the NBA. So we've been pretty good friends basically throughout the past 9 years. I think we met each other at the early stages of this decade, and this is the very first time that he's ever coming on the podcast. Very exciting stuff. He's from the DC area, or sort of from there, as he will get into at one point during the podcast. But we talked about his finish at SCG Baltimore this past weekend, where he had a personal record of 14-1 in the legacy chair of our team constructed open that just took place. Congratulations to champion Ryan Overturf, by the way, my commentary pal on the Big W, his second open win. Tommy not able to get the win, but a dominant performance with his deck this weekend. It is a really cool Arclight Phoenix deck, and he talks about how he kind of came to this, the matchup, so on and so forth. We talk about the communication or lack thereof with Wizards of the Coast for the changes to competitive play, and we also talked about some of these rule changes that I wasn't even aware of as far as takesy backsies are concerned, which are a little strange and could be the cause for concern in competitive Magic moving forward. But before we get to all of that, and trust me, it's pretty good, I do want to mention two things. One, some minor audio issues when I was recording this on Zencaster. In a weird way, there were moments when Tommy would kind of cut out a little bit, but it was brief. But every time he picked back up, it felt like he didn't cut out. So there will be some strange things that I'm sure my podcast editor, Jonathan Choi, not Joy, as he claims I said last week, Jonathan Choi, will be cleaning this up to make sure it sounds all good. But in a weird way, it all kind of worked out the way that we wanted it to. So I think this should still be a good listen, because there isn't, the quality appears to be fine. I don't really see anything too bad occurring. So hopefully you guys enjoy that. Other thing, obviously, is Jule Vera, J-U-L-E-V-E-R-A. They do the music for the podcast. Waiting on the Sun is the album. I listen to it on Spotify. You can listen to it on YouTube or wherever you get your musics. And now, for the first time ever, Stainerson. Everybody, welcome to another episode of the Cedric Phillips podcast. I'm your host with a glass of Justin Cabernet Sauvignon this Sunday evening as the Super Bowl is taking place. Cedric Phillips at Cedric A. Phillips on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. And I am joined by the one and only, people know you better as Stainerson than your real name, Tommy. How does that make you feel?
Fine. There's actually a couple Tommy Ashtons, and there's only one Stainerson, probably. Actually, I think it might be a common surname in like Sweden. I've gotten asked about Ersun and whether I was a Swedish Magic player, which I'm not.
Which, really? That's a thing that's happened?
Yeah. Something happened. Because they saw in my profile, it's supposed to say Stainy McStainerson, but there's an actual Magic player whose last name, when it's pronounced, is Stainerson, and it's spelled pretty close. Bjorn Stainerson.
That is a completely ridiculous story. I did not actually know that.
I assume it's Joel Larson, son of Lar, or Lars, son of Lars Thorin. And this is son of Stainer.
Can I call you can you make your next screen name on Magic Online or Arena son of Stainer?
Son of Stainer.
Perfect. We got you ready to rock and roll for your hidden account.
We're the Stainer brothers.
this is Tommy Ashton from, is DC accurate or what?
I will not say that I am from DC, because people who are from DC don't live as nice a life of privilege that I do in DC. people who are from DC, are kept to a very small quadrant of DC, treated poorly by the DC government, and frequently forced to move to a mediocre part of Maryland. I am from Maryland, and thus I am welcome in DC, as long as I'm young, white, and have money.
Which, apparently you have all those things, so congratulations to you.
Enough to be welcomed for now.
Until we push you out. It's time for you to go.
Yeah, until I'm from DC.
Well, here's the thing. You now have even more money after your fantastic performance this weekend at SCG Baltimore, 10th place, but a personal record of 14 and fun.
Yes.
You're playing Legacy. It actually kind of surprised me because I don't ever see you really playing Legacy like at all, unless you're doing it on that hidden account that we just talked about.
Yeah. Usually the last Legacy event I played was Grand Prix Seattle a full year ago. And it was only because it was in Seattle and I needed to get some kind of finish to get pro points that don't exist now. So people listening to this in the future won't even know what we're talking about. And I'm kind of an oddball when it comes to that. So I played like Steel Stompy at that one. And yes, Tim Wu was playing standard because he is testing for the Pro Tour, which I am not qualified for right now and won't be. And when we added Ben Nikolic, it's like, okay, well, clearly we know what he's doing. He's just playing horrible Jeskai.
Yes, horrible Jeskai indeed. Just the worst Jeskai deck of all time.
Yeah.
I mean, he wins with it. Do you think Jeskai's horrible?
Yes, I think it is really bad. With that next to him, yes. And he lost the first round to Burn, which I didn't know was a thing with Jeskai. You have like four Lightning Helix and main deck timely reinforcements. And then in the second round, he lost again to Burn. And then in the third round, he beat Tron, and he was happy to face Tron. It doesn't make any sense. And he talks about like have it like, okay, well, like I figured it out. Like you're supposed to be the aggro deck. And it's like, oh, why don't you play an actual aggro deck then? Like, you're aggro with Settle Wreckage in your deck. This doesn't make sense.
Only one this week, and he's played three before.
Yeah, that does it. Yeah. And all his lands, he has, like, an Odyssey Foil Island and a Grand Prix Plains from this year. And, like, nothing in his deck makes – it's not even, like, nicely foiled out. He foils it out intentionally to have as many versions as possible of his cards. Yeah, it's really bad.
Oh, Nikolic is so awesome. Yeah. I love it. I think the deck is horrible every time I watch it on camera. I think he's very good. I think the deck is horrible.
So I looked over and at one point I actually thought that he was not being aggressive enough in a match that we ended up drawing against Amulet. And I just can't say anything because I know he's really good at playing it, or he does really well with it and everything. And I also know that I lose whenever I play it because it's horrible. And so what possible insight do I have to offer other than a bunch of ways that whenever I make choices with the deck, I lose. So I'm not going to bother.
A perfect teammate for Ben.
Go ahead. Like, do whatever you want. And I couldn't even see Tim Wu's matches. So whatever.
Well, I imagine Tim's matches were over pretty fast. He was playing Azorius Aggro, a deck that weird. I played in the online PTQ, and I was just messaging you on Facebook over the past, I don't know, 48 hours and just being like, I'm pretty sure this deck is bad. I'm pretty sure this deck is bad. I don't know what Tim thinks of this deck. And it was on the winning team's list of decks. It was their standard deck. I still think the deck is bad.
They were, they beat us playing for top eight, and I was joking openly during the match, like that the deck was horrible. And Tim, like after the match was like, yeah, like this deck, like, oh, it's been like, I don't know what to think about this. I still don't understand standard. And his opponent was like, what are you talking about? Like, I'm 13-1 with this deck. This deck's amazing. Like, this deck's great. Like, are you kidding? This is one of the most powerful things I've played ever. And it's like, wait, what? And he, and one of the things that he mentioned was like the winner that was like, yeah, like, one thing that you have to know about the deck is like you just don't keep one land hands. And it's like, oh, that seems great. I wish I didn't have to keep one land hands, but sure. But it's, yeah, like, I mean, Tim kept a one lander on the play in after mulliganing in game three, and it was a Glacial Fortress, and he died because he got flooded. So that's another deck that in my hands, it never works right.
Yeah, I don't know. I've been playing this deck all weekend. I went 6-3 in the online PTQ, and I was actually thinking about auditing before the PTQ because I started off going 2-3 in a league and then 0-3 in a league, and I was just like, okay, this is the worst deck of all time.
Yeah, I would never play a deck like that again when I have that record with a deck, it's just done.
Yeah, I don't know if it was like a combination of like me not paying enough attention or me like kind of running bad or something, but I also just didn't feel that great against Sultai, and I knew that deck was going to be everywhere. And lo and behold, I did lose that deck twice in the PTQ after being up a game, losing games two and games three. weirdly, this deck doesn't feel like you're doing anything powerful.
No, and it needs to draw exactly the right number of lands, which I think is 4 each game, no matter what. And you have to draw, you have to play them the first 4 turns for sure. And you need to have a good mix of one drops and like 2s or history. And like you want the Loxodon Curve Topper. And yeah, I don't really get it. And like sometimes you're playing a 1 power creature on turn 1 and like a 2 power creature on turn 2, which is, and then they play like a Jade Light or a Wild Growth, or they play things that cost 6 and you're still playing things that cost 2. And yeah, it doesn't add up to me.
There's also this feeling of every game I played against Sultai where I'm just like, okay, gotta fade Finality. Just the entire game. I hope they don't draw it. I hope they Vivian Reed passed it or like all this other stuff. And it's just the worst feeling in the world. And with Finality, I thought initially that they had to have a creature to give counters to and they couldn't cast it. Wrong.
No, that is optional. And in fact, you like the deck doesn't have anything like Experimental Frenzy either. Oh, I should say also when I have played, I was playing Black Green mostly towards the end of the before Ravnica Allegiance came out, and I just couldn't beat White Weenie at all, no matter what, somehow. And it was the deck that was the best against me, and I get trashed by it every time, and I get trashed with it every time.
Oh, it's one of those decks where you can't possibly beat it, can't possibly win with it.
My history is never this is what happened to Tim happens to me. Like there's he played, his opponent didn't play anything, playing for top 8, didn't play anything in like the first, he played a Skymarcher Aspirant turn 1, a Dauntless Bodyguard, no, maybe not even a Bodyguard turn, he didn't do anything, he passed on like 3, passed on 4, and meanwhile Tim had like went history a Johnny. And then it was just over because the guy had Deputy of Attention, took both tokens, then like played his own thing, then like played another 2/1, then played a Johnny, pumped, attacked, like Tim just had a bunch of lands, like and it didn't make sense. He skipped like two or three of the most important turns of the game for the white deck, given the cards that it plays, and it didn't matter in the mirror. So yeah, I just don't. It's as incomprehensible to me as like Nexus of Fate is incomprehensible to Tim.
Oh, like does Tim just not win with Nexus of Fate?
No, or when Ben and I and him were talking about like what deck he should play, we suggested like a Nexus of Fate deck, and he's like, I don't know how to play Nexus of Fate. And Ben's just like, you cast it. That's you cast it each time that you draw it. And yeah, Tim, I would not want Tim to have to play that deck. It would be punishment for him to not get to attack.
Tim can't play that deck.
No, he is a white red mage.
Yeah, he just likes to attack. I mean, he likes to attack in limited. Yeah. He likes to attack in constructed. That's fine. Be who you are.
Yeah,
that's totally fine. Okay, so all right. So that's your team's decks. Horrible Jeskai control. Horrible Azorius aggro, and apparently pretty good Grixis Phoenix in Legacy.
Yes. Wow. Yes.
So I opened up the page on Star City, and I didn't know that like you had all these Dark Rituals and stuff. Like I knew you had Phoenix in your deck. I caught wind that you had Buried Alive in your deck, but I didn't get to watch that much coverage. Sorry about that, whammy. And I'm just seeing this, like I'm seeing these Tombstalkers and all this other crap. So give me the breakdown of how the hell you got to this.
So I started off first when I agreed to play in this tournament. And agreed to play Legacy. I was like, okay, well, I don't have anything else coming up. I'm actually going to dive into the format. And I immediately went to the best place for deck lists other than Star City Games, which is basically just started looking at what happened in Japanese tournaments because in addition to being like many hours ahead, they're just like years ahead, usually as part of construction.
Very, very true.
So I think it was, God, I'm going to butcher his first name, but his last name is Kuroda. His first name starts with an M, so I'm going to call him Mr. Kuroda. He won the Mirrodin Block Constructed Pro Tour, and he also won like a 100-something-odd person Legacy tournament playing Stoneblade, the blue-white Stoneforge deck. And so I figured I would start with that, and it was really good, and I could not beat Grixis Control for the life of me. And I would just get destroyed by Kolaghan's Command and just Baleful Strixes and a bunch of like mopey things that are more like that aren't that even good in modern now. And then I tried out a Esper Phoenix deck that had just 5-0'd some Modo name that I actually didn't recognize. And when I mentioned that I had 5-0'd with that in just like a random kind of like off-topic spam chat that the Pro Tour team that I was on had, Jarvis Yu said, "Oh, I know the guy who made it," which isn't a surprise because Jarvis knows basically everybody. And there was a separate like Arclight in Legacy chat that I actually usually wouldn't be interested in doing because I mean, I'm just going to like try and practice with one deck and figure out the format myself. But I decided to join in and yeah, they are really smart. And it's Callum Smith. I believe he's British or Irish. And it's probably really offensive for me to say it's one of those two, but yeah, in 2019, it's probably really offensive in 2020, but I'll get away with it for now.
You're probably safe now, but next year,
next year. And Peter White and Eric Landon, who is a notorious trophy leader in Legacy and basically popularized the Unmask like mono black version of Reanimator. And so, yeah, they were just involved in developing the deck a lot, figuring out whether it was better to be Esper or Grixis. And ultimately, I had to learn a lot about the deck and generally Legacy, like casting Brainstorm and how to do that. I did not really know that until this, which is why I did not play Brainstorm in Grand Prix Seattle. I played Steel Stompy because you just have to look at opening hands and play cards that I'm familiar with, like Arcbound Ravager. Brainstorm is a new thing.
Yeah, it's a little bit better than Arcbound Ravager.
Yeah, it's really like if you're doing it right, you have access to like the top 20 or 30 cards of your deck each turn. It was the closest I've felt to playing like old like versus system again, where you're just searching every turn and seeing like you can play whatever you want. I mean, again, like I'm casting Buried Alive most games, and I have four. Like in modern, you have to hope to draw Arclight Phoenix. And if you draw two, you're just going to win. As long as you draw Faithless Looting, which you also only have four of. And in modern, it just feels like you have 30 copies of Show and Tell or of Buried Alive or whatever you want.
Yeah, it's a little silly. So congratulations on graduating and upgrading to Brainstorm as opposed to stupid artifacts and hoping the top, I don't know, 13 cards of your deck are in the right order. Yeah.
When I set my deck down playing decks that I usually play, the order of the deck is fixed. The bottom card is what it's going to be, and it will never change.
Yeah, scry to the bottom. It's there. Come on,
I will never see that card again. It's like the most fatalistic way of playing Magic. The order is set, and now I just go through it. But yeah, you actually have involvement in your own matches when you're playing with like Brainstorm and Shuffle Effect.
All right, so this deck you went 14-1 with.
Yes.
Obviously, team tournament, so personal record doesn't matter that much. But at the same time, 14-1 is pretty outrageous. So,
correct.
Four Buried Alive, four Arclight Phoenixes, four Dark Rituals, two Tombstalkers, three Young Pyromancers, 16 lands, four Brainstorms, as we mentioned, four Cabal Therapies, Ponders, Preordains, Thought Seizes. I'm sure you have many a story, but first of all, just like, how good did this deck feel to play? Because this is a much different deck than we've seen in Legacy.
Everything is super smooth. And so one startling thing is that you can keep basically any hand that's a land and a cantrip. Wasteland is kind of like, it's not as super prevalent as it used to be. And also this deck frequently weirdly gets flooded off of its 16 and 3 petals. You can actually, cutting a land is possible and going down to 15 with this deck. And yeah, like everything's very, very smooth. I'm using most of my mana every turn and it just play. And also the other hallmark of the deck, that's basically a hallmark of all of the best decks in any format or of all the tier one decks, is that you are pretty much happy to have any one of the cards you just listed that are in the deck, all the 60, you are happy to have in your opening hand, and you are happy to draw later. So like the best Delver decks in like Delver in standard, like if you turn one it was awesome. And if you also played it like turns, like you're hoping to draw at turn six. And that's the same thing with like, I'm hoping to find a Dark Ritual on turn three, which is basically turn six for other formats. and give me every cantrip that I can. Finding Brainstorm on like turn three is just it's like your Ancestral Vision just unsuspended out of nowhere. Yeah, it just played very, very smoothly and efficiently and without any wasted motion. And even the cards that you'd think would only come in, like our fail rate cards, like drawing the Arclay Phoenix. Like, no, like I frequently won games this tournament and have in practicing for it where I will just cast, like I have ritualed out Dark Phoenix, Arclay Phoenix turn two and attack. And I have played it turn four off of four lands and had it been great, or turn three off of a pedal. Yeah, like everything. And I also think that Thoughtseize and like Therapy's good, but in particular Thoughtseize is insanely good in this format. You get to know your opponent's hand, which is a reason that Probe is rightfully banned. And dear God, if Probe was legal with Arclight Phoenix, that would be nice.
Wow. Yeah, your deck would be unbeatable.
Yeah, that was smart. But yeah, just like, and also everything costs one. Oh, it's so great. Like it's just so freaking smooth. The only, and I can go through some of the matchups that I played because it was pretty diverse.
I love that you're just gushing. It's like you, yeah. it's like the veil has been peeled off of like you don't have to play shitty Legacy decks anymore. Yeah.
No, well, so I've heard you in previous podcasts talking about like Thopter Depths, or like I'd compare also to like the four color Saheeli Felidar combo decks in Standard that had like the energy backup, or like the Teemer Marvel when it had like Whirl of Virtuoso and Marvel and could do all these different things on different axes. Like,
yeah.
My opponent starts with Leyline in play. Okay. Like I beat that over the weekend without removing it. My opponent has a hand, I Thoughtseize them and I see like Surgical, Snapcaster, Flusterstorm, Swords. Okay. Like beat that easily. Like all, there's so many different cards. Like having Pyromancer is less of a plan than it is like Pyromancer functions more kind of like a lightning bolt as far as just like transitioning you to different parts of the game and playing defense. But like it can function, and sometimes Tombstalker in particular, like those sometimes show up just as plans and dodge whatever hate you're actually facing. And so, yeah, I've faced plenty of Surgicals and Ley Lines and what I thought was hate on the weekend, and it didn't really matter.
And just plowed right through it like a good deck, like a great deck does. I don't want to say a good deck, like a great deck does, where you're just like, I don't care about. I mean, either they brought the wrong hate card, or they brought the right hate card, and you're just like, yeah, I don't care.
Yeah, and same thing. I mean, other, like, against, like, Green-Black Depths, like, I have won games where they attacked with Mara Lodge three times because I got a bunch of blockers. With the Buried Alive brings in two, like three blockers against Infect. I Buried Alive and brought back one attacker, two blockers, until I was ready to kill him because and Ink Moth and Glistener Elf with a Hierarch in play were just stopped because I had 2/3/2 flyers on defense.
Buried Alive. Okay. It is three creature cards. I just wanted to make sure I wasn't crazy.
Hypothetically,
it's not just three cards.
You can actually get a Narc Amoeba and put that in the play off of it. That's another, that was a potential thing that has been, like, if you want to play that, you can fetch that and then, like, Flashback of Therapy to give you an extra spell if you're going to have trouble bringing back the Arc Lights. That was, like, a cutting, like, left on the cutting room floor, but that's an option.
That's a very adorable interaction.
Yeah.
Super adorable. All right, matchups. Give me some minor breakdowns here.
Okay, so I played against Stoneblade twice, my runner-up choice, and that is a horrible matchup for Stoneblade. so the good thing, some cards that are really good in their deck are Jace, which doesn't do anything against 3/2 hastes, whether in multiples or even solo just to kill it. Let's see, Stoneforge the card, Stoneforge Mystic, hypothetically Badger Skull is, I mean, I can't really remove it from play, but it's the easiest therapy target in the world after somebody plays Stoneforge. This card is just insanely good against them. Same True Name Nemesis, doesn't matter. Nothing in their deck is flying. They can't board in Rest in Peace because they have Snapcasters, so they board in Surgicals, which just sit in their hand until I get to Cabal Therapy them. Yeah, like that deck didn't have a chance either time. Black Red Reanimator, I actually, like, first, the deck's really flimsy, and it, like, if they don't turn one you, and you actually get to play a turn one discard spell, usually that will screw them. And then also, like, Tormod's Crypt is much better than having Surgicals, even though it's an Arc-like deck. Like, basically, sideboard plus a timely discard spell or one of the dazes just shuts them off, besides their own very high fail rate. Elves just really... I had an Engineered Plague in the sideboard before, which really would have been nice, because you can just ritual that out, or, like, the other people in the chat were suggesting, like, yeah, you can just have a Plague, ritual it out, turn one against them, or have Liliana, the Last Hope, ritual that out. Good luck.
They're just so dead. Oh, yeah. My God.
So in that flex spot, I went with Marsh Casualties, which I ritualed out to kick to kill a Scavenging Ooze, as well as the rest of their team. And yeah, like, their deck just, I mean, they can't turn one you with Glimpse. They can turn two. So it lets you get in a Thoughtseize, or on turn one, you're always therapying them for Glimpse. And then if they're not doing that, it's like, I have lost once to that elf that's a Monarch card, because surviving discard, like, if a deck can survive discard without losing to Phoenix early for whatever reason, like, they can actually win. So Miracles with, like, Accumulated Knowledge is good. But it was this Monarch card that's like a five mana 4/4 that's an elf, and you become the Monarch. And if that thing stuck in a turn with, like, Scavenging Ooze, that's how they would beat you. But the elves otherwise, I mean, nothing has flying, obviously. Grixis Control, kind of same as Stoneblade. Like, they're like, Kolaghan Command doesn't do anything. Baleful Strix is kind of mopey. Force of Will is pretty mediocre against this deck, because you can play a pretty good fair game with Arc Lights. So their deck wasn't that great. Delver is close, and I beat my opponent. Same thing with Death Shadow. Just because they're so aggressive, and Thoughtseize can be a liability sometimes. And Wasteland with Pressure is a way to beat this deck. That was how I actually did lose, which was to Eldrazi Aggro, because in one game he went turn one Thorn, turn two Thought Knot, and then, like, a Wasteland that, and even though I was able to abrade, he was able to stop that by just pressuring me. Another game he went turn one double Mimic, turn two, like, I had to Thoughtseize a Chalice, then he went Endless One Attack for 8, and I was just under the gun too quickly. But I beat Eldrazi Post twice, because they have like 3 mana on turn 2, which isn't important.
They're trying to do something completely absurd. Don't care.
I mean, I played, like, and I did lose a game where they resolved an Ulamog, but because they drew 2 Glimmer Post, but I also then turn 1 to them, and they can't play Surgical in their deck, because they have Chalice. So, and nobody's adopted Ravenous Trap, which would be a big beating against me, which I would probably never name with Cabal Therapy at first. I beat 2 of those Eldrazi Posts, because they were just kind of slow. Red Prison. Blood Moons don't really do much against me. The petals help a lot, and also so does casting Arclight. I did that a bunch. I just mowed through. Oh, Aggro Loam. My opponent, I played Thoughtseize and Preordain and a Therapy and a Petal, and he died when he took 16 from his Sylvan Library and a Fetch, and I just bolted him out of nowhere. And he just didn't see Bolt coming, because I'm Storm, hypothetically, in his mind. That covered everything that I played against, really. The only things that gave me a ton of trouble online were Miracles with Accumulated Knowledge, because they have so many damn sideboard cards that you need to Thoughtseize through, and then they beat your discard with Accumulated Knowledge. And then, yeah, Eldrazi Aggro is pretty bad for me.
So I like that this deck can play, like, a normal Legacy game with all the cantripping and everything, but also just has, like, this weird turn one of, you know, like, land, ritual, buried alive, I guess, petal, or, like, land, ritual, ritual, buried alive, get back your idiots, or land, ritual, lotus petal, cantrip, buried alive, 3 arc lights, and then, you know, take 9 on turn one. It's like, okay, this game is over.
Yeah, the petal is the huge development. That was, there had been versions of the deck without, like, Grixis versions without Petal. There's an Esper version that plays Monastery Mentor, and that, like, Petal's good in that list because it triggers Mentor. And it turns out that just having Petal is great. And you don't, because you cantrip so much, you see a fair amount of lands. You're not force of willing, so you're never, like, none of your cards, all your cards are one for one. The dazes and therapy and thoughtseize. Like, you never have to two for one yourself with force. And so you're never really, like, Hymn to Torok, actually really good card against this deck, because nobody else otherwise gets card advantage against you. Usually they're being forced to two for one themselves against Force of Will, or if they have to counter or deal with a Phoenix that's just going to come back and stuff like that.
I love it.
Yeah. So the deck, the deck is great. I had to learn a lot to play it, but that involved, I mean, still, like, there's a lot of interesting situations, like in the feature match area against Elves on day two. So today I therapied, I went turn one, ritual, therapy you, therapy myself for two arc lights, attack for six, next turn, preordain, flashback of therapy with an arc light, flashback of therapy with the other arc light, bring those back, attack for six again. He doesn't have any cards in hand now. Like, and that was without Buried Alive. And without even, like, I didn't even have to cantrip much to set it up. Yeah, it's awesome. And starting out, like, again, like, start turn one preordain was my most common opener of the tournament. And turn two, fetch land, brainstorm, crack the fetch, thoughtseize or therapy you. Sometimes play a petal to protect my brainstorm or my preordain from being dazed. And yeah, usually I'm not going off turn one or turn two. I'm basically just making sure the coast is clear, because they're dead in a turn when you actually Buried Alive.
Yeah, they're dead. They're just dead like the next turn.
Yeah, it's three Hasted Delvers. Flip.
Yeah. Yeah, 9/9, they've probably taken some damage from fetches or whatever. Yeah, so they're just dead.
And usually, again, like Tombstalker and Young Pyromancer are to just clear the way. Like, they're almost discard spells.
Why Tombstalker? I don't get it.
So it blocks Delver flipped, which is nice. And also it came up so much just like having flying. Like, so the cards to remove from your graveyard isn't a big deal at all, because you don't play Snapcaster, you really don't care. I sometimes pretended like I was removing certain things with any rhyme or reason, but it really doesn't matter. You fetch almost every turn. Because you're cantripping into fetches and keeping the fetches. So the extra mana off of, compared to Angler, doesn't really matter. And yeah, it's just it's a big threat that doesn't get bolted, that, like, if you play that and then untap, play a Phoenix, that's eight. It blocks Thought Not Seer. It doesn't get chumped ever by any token or whatever. Yeah, it was just, I would never have chosen to play Tombstalker without other people. I would probably never have added Tombstalker to any deck since Angler was printed, but people smarter than me have figured out that flying's good in Legacy.
Smart. I guess there are some matchups. Maybe you have to block some Arc Light Phoenixes. Who knows?
Yeah, I really wouldn't consider any, like, the way that outsiders, like I am usually, perceive Legacy is, like, the card could have flanking for all I care. Like, I don't care about keywords on my creatures. They're supposed to have really good abilities or something like that. But yeah, it's actually important.
Fair enough. All right, so this deck's great. This deck's the nuts. If I were to play in a Legacy tournament, which I don't think I have one for any amount of time,
yeah,
I should just play this. Yeah, I can't actually think. I think there's like a GP in Niagara Falls.
There's a bunch of future developments to be made to this deck. A lot of them, actually. I think that, so the deck could trim a land if it wanted. It doesn't have to have Bolt. It should probably still have two days no matter what. I dazed my own spell a lot. And I dazed a lot of important things on their side, but my own spell a lot, just to get Buried Alive off. The deck could play Confidant. Confidant would have to pitch the Tombstalkers out of the deck, but other than that, it's a great way to... Oh, another bad matchup is lands, and so I can only figure that just drawing two a turn uncontested is at least a start to beating a bad matchup. I think that you can also go white for Monastery Mentor. You can also, if there's some other threat out there that you can ritual out on turn one that isn't Hypnotic Spectre or Phyrexian Negator, but an actual card, like Liliana, either Liliana could actually be a good development for the deck. I think that there's, like, the flex, the 12 cantrips, 2 days, 4 Arclight, 4 Buried Alive, 4 Ritual, and Petals are set in stone. But Tombstalker and Pyromancer and Lightning Bolt, those can all change. Oh, and the discard Set in Stone also. But there's like probably 7 flex spots at least.
There's probably some stupid card you could sideboard in a ritual into.
Yeah, I won't figure it out myself. I'm counting on a 1,000 monkeys working all hours of the day to peck away at their typewriters, if monkeys can peck, to figure out the card.
Yeah, I mean, someone out there will just be like, yeah, obviously you just buried a life for this thing, or you ritual into this 3-mana thing and they're dead. And it's like, oh, okay, I didn't know that.
Oh, also, ritual, sometimes, just a nice card. Like, I ritualed out Tombstalker at one point. Like, that was kind of nice. Sometimes I'll ritual and, like, turn one, ritual. Well, I guess this happened more with the Mentor version, where you would go land, pedal, ritual, Mentor, Thoughtseize, turn two, cantrip, attack for 5. That adds up quicker than Pyromancer does. But, yeah, ritual just to accelerate sometimes is nice. It's super underplayed. It's only in Storm, right? Like, I think it's a super underplayed card.
It's only in Storm and in various combo decks. Like, I used to play way back when, in like, this was like 09, 10. I used to play like a Sinkhole deck that had 4 rituals in it.
Oh, yeah. Like you said, a combo deck. You're right.
Yeah. Yeah. It's the perfect combo deck. Kill your land. That's game then? Or is that a fetch land?
No, I think that's a fetch land. I think that it was a big development to have the Reanimator move away from Force of Wills and add in like Dark Rituals and stuff that sped it up. And I think that people should be looking for more ways to play Dark Ritual. Like, I would wager that in Pox, like, the best card is probably Ritual. Or at least it's in the top 2. And there's probably a huge gap between it and the next best card. Like, Ritual is a card that is too good for other formats. And we should be using it now.
Yeah, I mean, well, and Ritual in this deck is completely...
Yes, completely busted. I definitely have turn 1 the 9 damage. I've turn 2'd it with regularity. If you told me that my opponent had sorcery speed cards in their hand at all times, I would just turn to it over and over.
Yeah, you're done.
Yeah.
Game's over. All right. Okay, so that's that deck. Let's see, where do we go to next? Do we talk about these changes in the rulings and the stuff you have to deal with?
One thing I want to add, just to clear the air and have a clean record about this tournament. So I did go 14-1 and did not top 8. Because my team's record was not good enough for top 8. However, my teammates are great. It was super fun playing next to them and playing with them. And the other thing is that I would not have attended the tournament if it was a solo legacy tournament. So it wouldn't matter if my record was good enough for a solo open, because I wouldn't have been there. I only came because it was a team tournament. So,
God, what a team player you are. Yeah. Look at you. Very LeBron-esque of you. All right, we're going to talk about these new rulings and some of the stuff you had to deal with the tournament right after this quick break. Quick word from our friends over at Ultimate Guard, your home for premium protection products. And the sleeves that I've talked about so much are finally here. The Katana sleeves have arrived. It is a new dynasty in card protection. How do you like that catchphrase? That one sticks, right? You can protect your cards like a samurai would with our brand new Katana sleeves, as this website reads. I actually helped do the copy for this. I'm kind of proud of these next couple of lines. Honoring the tradition of pristine Japanese craftsmanship, these precision-made and extremely durable sleeves are ideal for tournament gameplay. They're fully opaque, great for shuffling, and meet the highest standards of players and collectors. And if you know Tolarian Community College and you subscribe to his channel, you're one of like over 400,000 subscribers or some egregiously large number, you know that he gave the Katana sleeves an A. So, don't take my word for it, take his word for it. That's like his job, you know? To know these kind of things, and he gave them a resounding A. Honestly, these sleeves are actually fantastic. I've been playing Magic for a very long time, obviously, and these are almost without question the best sleeves I've ever played with. So if they're good enough for Tolarian and they're good enough for me, presumably they're good enough for you. Comes in 10 different colors: black, blue, white, translucent, orange, yellow, purple, green, turquoise, blue. I think that's all 10. Either way, you can head over to ultimateguard.com, learn more about these, find them at a local retailer near you. Ultimate Guard, for gamers, from gamers. Back to Tommy. All right, so one Ari Lax, our teammate at Grand Prix Detroit many years ago.
Yeah.
He's been on the social medias, and he is none too pleased with some of these new rules that have changed. I didn't even know there was a change in the rules by Toby Elliott and company. I had no idea until you and Ari brought this up.
They changed the policy. The policy has been this policy for a bit. It just had not been codified in an authoritative format as Toby Elliott put it in. And the article, you might have also had difficulty figuring it out, because the article that Toby Elliott wrote was from the perspective of a member of the Simic Guild.
It was
on the Mothership website, wizards.com, magic, whatever. And it references splicing creatures together and adding extra arms. And it's very thematic. It's not always easy to read if from a gathering the rules perspective. From a fiction perspective, it's entertaining. And I guess sometimes when applied to people who don't know the take back rules, they kind of seem fictional. But the communication process is ongoing, I think. People were learning. Definitely in some matches, I watched people learn.
Yeah, so I want to talk about these matches in which people learned, because I'm not even that familiar with like what's going on here. I guess it has a lot to do with being able to take things back and how we're going to handle that moving forward. The old takesy-backskies.
Yeah.
Like you can play a land, think, and then I guess take that back if you don't take another game action.
The way that it was described to a friend of mine the situation that came up was that my friend is playing Burn. And he attacked with Goblin Guide at one point against Dredge and revealed a Creeping Chill on the top of the guy's deck, which is really, really, really difficult for Burn to beat free in mana and free in cards, Lightning Helixes. He's fearing that. And then his opponent at the end of his turn sacrifices Wooded Foothills. And my friend is pleased by this action because now Creeping Chill will not be on top of the deck. Until the person who has put Wooded Foothills in the graveyard and lost a life realizes that Creeping Chill is going to get shuffled away and says, no, I'm not going to do that, and puts his Wooded Foothills back into play and doesn't lose a life. And that's when my friend finds out that you can take this back.
That doesn't seem like something you should be able to take
back. And
the
explanation given is that after it was appealed to the head judge, and also my friend was probably borderline unsportsmanlike, because it did reach the point where his teammate had to like tap him on the leg and tell him to let this go, was a normal reaction. Potentially a normal reaction.
For this human, yes.
Basically... He was told, well, you didn't – like no information has been given away. And he said, well, what is information? What does that mean? And then the judge said, well – I think the explanation turned into, well, it was that no game action was taken, which my friend then suggested was different than information. But one interesting thing is, okay, well, he's playing Burn. It's not like – I mean – what information can he give away? That Creeping Chill's bad, like, for him? So I guess it's true that, if the only thing was that my friend smiled because his opponent was doing something favorable for him, then, he didn't give away any information about – he did not suggest what cards were in his hand or give away anything otherwise secret. So I guess that's that. You can go back. Nothing's changed.
Okay, so the first thing that just jumped to my head is, okay, so if I crack a fetch on a Magicka line, or I know they aren't on Arena yet. I don't know if I presume they will be at some point. Can I just go like, actually, I don't want to do that? Like, how does
Well,
how
you
does
can
that
press Control Z. In this situation, it won't do anything. I mean, lands are on Arena. Lands, not fetch lands, but lands are. If you play a land, you cannot pick it back up. Well, that's not true. In paper magic, you can. Tabletop magic. As long as nothing else happened. And, I mean, so another situation. Tim Wu, my teammate at the Pro Tour, has one of his opponents, plays some spells, t- Tax with Crackling Phoenix. Tim's playing Experimental Frenzy Red. Tim basically clarifies, like, okay, so you've attacked with Crackling Phoenix or Crackling Drake. He says yes. Tim's like, okay, no blocks. And the guy then counts to figure out how big Crackling Drake is, notices an arc light in the graveyard, and is like, okay, well, this is coming in. And Tim suggests, no, you missed the trigger. But that's not true, because they rewound and let the arc light come in. And Tim is as boondoggled or runeboggled or whatever it is by this happening as you or I or anybody else would be. And so he then calls a judge, invariably leading to an appeal to the head judge. And he's basically told, well, no information was given away. This doesn't change. Basically, like, oh, yeah, he forgot, but that doesn't mean anything. Like, it didn't advantage him to forget, or like he didn't like bait you into something. And Tim actually did argue that, hey, I've got a mountain untapped and I have an experimental frenzy in play. And the actions that I did or did not take could have demonstrated whether I had a shock on top. And the head judge says basically, well, that's true. That's a good argument. Okay, we won't let him get the Arclight Phoenix. So in that case, Tim successfully defended his thesis, his hypothesis, that yes, I could give away information, and information could have been gleaned from that play. So basically, if somebody is making a take back and it could be advantageous for them kind of in a game beyond the game way, then they can't do it. But if it's not, then they can.
Oh, I bet this won't get messy at all.
Well, think about this. Say that you're playing Bernie, you're tapped out. Can you give away any information? No. Say that you are playing a deck in Legacy that has Underground Sea, or any card that has the card type Island, or any deck that has any number of blue spells in it. Your opponent plays anything. Are you giving away information? Yes. Well, if my opponent uses a fetch land, I could stifle it, or I couldn't, and maybe sacrificing that gives away information if I don't respond immediately. So actually, the action that my friend's opponent took with sacrificing the fetch land probably could or should lead to a different ruling depending on format.
And you can't judge by format, I don't think.
Well, it could also lead to a different thing based on deck list, because now they actually did print a stifle in standard. So like,
that's a very good point.
If maybe you can't take back Evolving Wilds if you're playing forests or islands.
Oh god.
But if you're mono red, you can't stifle that. So sacrificing Evolving Wilds is something that can be taken back.
But what if I'm splashing blue or green?
Well, then you're going to have to be able to successfully articulate that.
Yeah, but what if I'm some maniac who's splashing blue or green for the stifle, and I don't know what the back half of that card is, but you don't know me.
That's true. In fact, there's plenty of people. I mean, you may not know that there's a stifle in there, which would disadvantage your, like, if you don't know that the stifle exists, then I can't tell you the name of the card, but
it's some split card. I don't know the name of it either.
Yeah, I know. I actually don't even think I know either name of that card on that card. But yeah, like, if you don't know that card exists, or you can't remember its name, then it's going to be really difficult to make your argument and then win a judge call regarding your opponent's action that they want to rescind.
Yeah. I guess you have to weirdly come super prepared to tell them that It's repopulate, replicate.
Yeah. Well, now I understand that that this is being handled by judges. It's got judge, can't spell judgment without judge, depending on how you're spelling it. I think you're not
That's right.
actually spell, you're supposed to not have the first E in it, but.
It's not supposed to have the E, and people put it in there all the time.
Yeah. I did that a lot when the set judgment came out. I was also really young.
Yep.
But I also couldn't spell Odyssey either. I understand judges being able to exercise judgment, and I think that judges should be enabled to exercise judgment or prepared to exercise judgment even more than they are now, because a lot of things that people do in games of paper tabletop Magic at for when it's competitive and there's something on the line, frequently I think that there's plenty of people who are happy to push boundaries and or sometimes step over boundaries, particularly when their opponent isn't experienced enough to know that that's happening. And I want judges to be able to effectively police that. Also, at the same time, I don't know if this is a gray area I want anybody, like, it would make things a lot easier if we just knew what, if people knew some kind of consistency. Like, the judge might be able to rule with consistency depending on the format, but I won't know the answer.
Yeah, it's just way too gray.
Yeah, and I mean, I also, good luck explaining this to somebody who doesn't speak your language.
Oof. Yeah, like a, I don't know, mythic championship in a couple of weeks?
Yeah. Now, yeah. This is, yeah, so that's, I feel that they might have, in this situation, taken something that can kind of be a flaw of paper magic, tabletop magic at times, and exacerbated it. And I don't like that, because generally I think that they have been good at fine-tuning the product to be better and more consistent with, like, across formats and across platforms.
Yeah, this almost feels like a step backwards in some respects.
Well, have you heard about PAX? Not PAX. PAX? Not, PAX, not PAX East, but PAX.
Not PAX East, where I'll be?
P.S. PAX.
No, I have not.
So, are you aware of the card Summoning Pact?
Or I am.
Pact of Negation. Or I guess, like, Hyper Slug or whatever that unglued card was, or Unhinged.
Well, you know, people don't give Intervention Pact enough respect, so I'll throw that out there.
So, what happened at the tournament? In a feature match, maybe not on camera, I can't remember. Ben Nicklich is playing against Amulet, which is a deck that plays multiple different packs from a future site. And the opponent played a Pact of Negation, and then on Ben's turn, and then he untapped, and then he drew his card. And then Ben, having played with packs in a while, knows, hey, during your opponent's upkeep after they cast it, it says literally they're being asked a question. Do you want to lose? Circle yes.
No.
And
no, I do not.
His opponent didn't circle yes or no, just went on. And Ben, while looking at this, is like, okay, well, my opponent lost then. Calls judge. And actually, the opponent didn't and gets to pay now. Because the rule is that if your opponent misses a trigger, at any time, you can remind them of the trigger and put it, and then choose whether to put it on the stack at that moment. So actually, Ben could have done the guy a solid and just said, oh, you didn't want to pay for the pact? Well, fine. You don't have to even. I'm not going to put it on the stack. But yeah, what happened was that he chose to put it on the stack, and then he got to pay it and go on with life. This is tough because not that this happened with this opponent, but if the opponent had drawn a Simian Spirit Guide, they don't go back before you draw the Simian Spirit Guide. They make you pay then, and you could have exiled the card that you drew to pay for the pact, and you didn't have the card when the pact was originally supposed to be paid.
Not good.
And the one thing, like, the pact says on the on the card, you lose the game. There's nothing more serious.
Yeah, I don't understand. Like, I don't understand why we have all these rulings around packs to make it so it's like, okay, you made a mistake. You don't actually lose. You just made a little boo-boo. It's like, if I am writing down Slaughter Pact on my deck list, I know what I'm signing up for.
Well, yeah, that's the thing. So I totally understand changing rules to be less harsh as far as immediate disqualifications for not being legible on your deck list or missing a card or all sorts of things. Like 10 or 20 years ago, everything was super, super harsh. Unduly harsh. And if you're in your first tournament and you get DQ'd for something, for like leaving cards off your deck, which isn't even helpful to you, then like, what the hell? Why am I going to play this game? And so, yeah, I'm all for not having feel bad moments. However, if you're trying to avoid feel bad moments, then you should not put a card in your deck that says you lose the game. It, like, maybe it would have been like, maybe on reprintings of packs, they should put that in bold or caps.
Well, I don't think
we're different.
I don't want to say never, but you know, I doubt they'll ever bring this mechanic back.
Yeah.
But I do hate the way the packs are adjudicated so much, because it's just like, no, like, you fucked up, you lose. That's what happens now. Like, put a giant thing on your deck, or know that you played a pact, and like, this is what happens when you do this, which is why these are powerful.
Yeah.
Like, I don't like that you get to like, oops, call a judge, I forgot to pay for my pack. Now, and the judge just like, okay.
I understand that Future Sight opened up a Pandora's box of a million regrettable things. But like, man, like, I didn't realize that they'd influence the rules of tournament magic also. And like, I mean, I remember it was pretty hurtful to, I had a lot of Massacres die back in the day, because back in the day was when I was like 14. So, it was horrible. Massacre was really, really not as good a card in my hands. But yeah, like, it's not even an issue of you knowing the rules, really, because it says really clearly. Also, unfortunately, I had to tell Ben, I had to ask him, hey, was the guy, like, did you notice the trigger or did he? And Ben, my teammate, says, well, like, I noticed it and I called him out after he missed it because I thought that I'd win the game. And I said, that sucks, because what you should have done, knowing that your opponent missed this trigger that's important that he has to do, you should have waited. And you should have waited for him to cast Primeval Titan, maybe for him to activate Slayer's Stronghold. You should have asked him, okay, so you've got a Colony Garden and a Radiant Fountain untapped, and you're attacking, and Primeval's trigger's on the stack. Did you pay for Pact? And the guy would say no. And then they call a judge. The judge would say, Ben, do you want to put this requirement that he pay blue 3 or lose on the stack? And Ben would say yes.
Yes, I would.
And then he would die. So what you didn't do, what you did, the problem is your opponent missed something and you tried to correct it. You shouldn't have done that until it was of the most advantage to you intentionally. See, that feels dirty and that feels wrong. And like you're intentionally high, like you're sitting there, like you just stole something and you're like, and a police officer is walking by you. And there's no reason for him to even know that you stole this freaking cookie or whatever, but you're just waiting for him to pass. Like, let me get away with this. Like, that's a feeling we all know that isn't something that I really want my opponents ever being forced to do.
Yeah, or even think about.
Yeah, because you're not like, yeah, the way that I hide information is in my hand, which is face down. But I shouldn't have to be thinking about the best way to like lie or look the other way to like not bring attention to the pact until I get to bring it up successfully. And I shouldn't be crossing my fingers like that I get away with it is basically what it feels like. And that's kind of what you're supposed to do now. Like if you tell your opponent that they missed their pact, I mean, that's just something you should never do. Like if anything, you could wait 3 turns and do it. For an advantage, you should just string it out. And that becomes then the game is hoping my opponent taps out as opposed to hoping that I can do enough damage to bring them to 0.
Yeah, I mean, it's just not magic anymore.
Yeah, or it's like some extra bluffing game. And I mean, other people find enjoyment out of that. But generally, I do not. If I'm going to prove that I'm smarter and better, I'll do it by bringing them to 0. Not bringing them to 4 blue mana instead of 5.
Yeah, yeah. Ooh, did you, you thought about playing that Titan, didn't you? All right, well, now's good.
Come on, please let him play Titan. Please let him tap out. Please, come on, it's not a good spell, play it, please. You know you can. I know you can't, but you don't know you can't. Fall into the trap.
I think there will be some interesting stories about this whole thing coming up soon.
Yeah, they're going to be stories about how the judge came and told them the policy. Like, they're going to tell, like, the funny thing is that all the stories will just be this rule that is the rule applied. And it's horrible. And I'm going to tell it to you because it's going to be shocking, even though it's the way the rules are.
Just the way the rules communicated. I sit on the internet all day and do magic, and I did not know about these changes.
Yeah, well, so I don't know how you'd find the link other than, I mean, there's the Twitter account, but I don't follow magic judges because generally, like, I don't really want to, I mean, I want to, I am happy to call a judge when necessary. However, generally, like, the best matches that I play don't involve judges being called. And I'm not talking about just Magic Online, because there's plenty of matches that I play on there that aren't the best matches. But but generally, it's when everything's being communicated great, and there aren't any problems, and frequently, not as frequently nowadays, but frequently in the past, when a judge is called, somebody feels bad afterwards or kind of angry or sometimes isn't as pleased with their opponent or isn't as pleasant. And so that's not great. And I think this is going to up that a little bit. And yeah, I'm not enthused.
Fair enough. We got one more thing to talk about. It's the PAX tournament that I'll be playing in. at the end of March. And we'll talk about that right after this. Now it's time for a quick word from our friends over at Star City Games, the world's largest Magic the Gathering store. This weekend, I'm headed to Dallas-Fort Worth because I gotta go cover the SCG Dallas Open weekend. Little standard action. I actually played in a PTQ online this past weekend, went 6-3 with Azorius Aggro, but that deck was actually the winning standard deck for the team open in Baltimore last weekend. So it seems like a pretty good option if you're looking to play a little standard down south in the Big D. I'll be joined by Patrick Sullivan, Baltimore champion Ryan Overturf, Todd Anderson, Nick Miller, and the rest of the SCG Tour crew as we work our way through 15 rounds of Ravnica Allegiance standard action. I'm looking forward to this tournament. Got to do release weekend in India a couple weeks ago. That was awesome. This will be an evolution of that tournament, so I imagine this one will be awesome. If you can't join us there, be sure to join us over at twitch.tv/SCGTour. Kicking it off, 10:30 Dallas time, so 11:30 Eastern for that time zone stuff, since Dallas is central. We'll see you there. We'll have some fun. Put on a great show. Probably talk a little bit about Tiktone and various other things. And maybe, even maybe, Tommy's got a recommendation for a deck to play. Speaking of which, let's go back to me and Tommy. So, on when was it? It was Thursday. So a handful of days ago, the wonderful people over at Wizards of the Coast released an article about the Mythic Championship tournament that's taking place on Arena that many have been wondering how they qualify for outside of the MPL being qualified for it. And well, we learned a lot more about that. We learned that yours truly is qualified.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much.
They should just send you that check for $7,500 right now.
Well, I hope to win more than that. I can see you have a lot of confidence in me, so thanks. Right. Yeah, okay.
Send it there.
Yeah, just PayPal, Venmo, however you got, direct deposit, however you guys want to do it, works for me. It's fine. I don't have to buy the flight, don't need to do the hotel, save the trouble. You can just Venmo at Cedric A. Phillips, Venmo.
Oh yeah, you do have Venmo there. I hope they set it up so that you're playing like Battleship against the other person. Your computers are just touching.
Yeah, we're just going to be at PAX East. There's going to be 64 computers, presumably. So, and, you know, who knows what's going to happen. But, you know, it's for spectacle and show. And they invited a lot of influencers. That's a key word, especially if you've watched the Fire Festival documentary.
Yeah, not a key word influencer.
They've invited influencers like myself. And then there's this arena grind for the top 8 arena finishers will also be qualified for this tournament. Tommy, you are a longtime Magic Online player and have played in, how many PTs have you played in? Do you know?
PTs, more than 20, maybe 30, something like that, between 20 and 30.
Okay, so you've played in a decent amount of PTs and play a ton of Magic Online and everything else.
Because the answer, because if you asked me how many PTQs that I've qualified for the Pro Tour with, I'd probably say 20, maybe 30, somewhere between 20 and 30. Almost one per PT. So
some egregiously large number.
Yeah.
I think I've won 13 PTQs and you're one of the few people who have won more than me.
Yeah, well, it's at some point it stops being a compliment.
That's true. I feel the exact same way.
Yeah, you know, like Reed Duke, like he busted his ass playing Magic Online. He advanced and qualified for the Pro Tour, and then you never saw him on Magic Online again. He went to college. He left. It was gone. And me, I'm still like, oh, you're working that same job still? Oh, yeah, still here. Oh, you're back in town for the reunion. That's great.
That's great. I'm still just still Standerson online. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, what you been up to? Yeah, just playing the cues.
So we've got this we've got this tournament, and there was a lot of backlash and hoopla, and people are angry. And I talked about this on my stream a little bit, but I mean, Magic player is going to complain and be angry because that's what Magic players do. And though I am one of the people that is privileged enough to be invited, I don't know. I think this thing is totally fine because it's just an exhibition, even though it wasn't really announced, unfortunately, as an exhibition.
Yeah, well, the issue is there. I mean, honestly, so there's Mythic Championships, and now there's a Mythic Invitational. Maybe just don't use the word Mythic for both. because it just makes me think that they're attached, that they're close together for some reason, and they're kind of easy to confuse. You could just call this the Pro-Am. It's like the golf tournament where Tony Romo gets to play. Like, You're Tony Romo in this. Sorry. You're not Tiger.
What's, dude, that's, I'm, Tony Romo just got paid $7,500. I don't give a shit.
Tony Romo.
Yeah, dude, I'll take being Tony Romo every day of the week. Doesn't seem like a bad life for that guy.
Yeah, I mean, and also, I understand that, like that it's, a lot of people do look at responses on Twitter and basically say, like, oh, the Magic community is angry about this, but they're always angry and they're always negative. I mean, how many people are complaining about Ravnica Allegiance? How many people say this is horrible and I hate this? This is bad. This is a bad set. You did a bad job. Not a lot. Everybody's kind of having fun. Like when Arena came out, like everybody could join, everybody could play. Like all a bunch of pros suddenly heard like, oh, Arena's great. This is really fun. I'm coming back to Magic for the first time. And they're like, there's no way this is good. Like animations, that's dumb. Sounds, I don't like those. I just like to sit in silence. Like without any stimulus, any visual stimulus at all. They liked Arena. So I mean, some people have things to say about this that aren't positive. But when there are positive things, they actually do say a lot of positive stuff too. So I don't know if I just say that everybody's a hater. I don't really love saying like, oh, it's the mob mentality, because also a lot of the criticism isn't just the mob, or I mean, a lot of people may be saying no, but you don't, but they might be saying no for a lot of different reasons, and so they're not necessarily all united in why they're displeased with something.
Sure, I mean, I get that. I guess, you know, so there are plenty of people who play this game professionally and grind away and everything like that, who are upset because it wasn't communicated how they would qualify for such a tournament. And I do agree that the branding is not great because people thought it was something that it wasn't, even though I don't think it was ever announced what it was going to be. So maybe people were working under an assumption that maybe they shouldn't have had, but I think that's arguable. I don't know. I do understand the frustration that your gold, silver, and bronze level pro has right now of, hey, what the hell? What's going on with competitive Magic right now? This is a big aspect of my life, and I don't understand what's going on. But I think a lot of that anger has bled over into this, and I don't know if it's justifiably so or not.
Well, so a lot of people who say, so there's people who are affected by this in that basically they want to play in this, or that they want to know that there's a way that they could have played in this, even though, I mean, there is the Arena top eight, but they wanted to, they feel that they have gone from being relatively enfranchised to not being enfranchised now. And that sucks for them. And so they want in. Then also there's a lot of other people on the outside who want to watch people that they like, and they want to also believe that things are a meritocracy, and define it the way that they define it. And yeah, so there's going to be a lot of different ways to attack this. The issue is that when I was in the Magic Online Championship Series, I got invited to the tournament because I got a bunch of at-large points from grinding away on Moto each all year. And when I showed up, I was saying like, hey, you just chose Modern and Draft. Why didn't you choose like Cube or like Modern with a new ban list entirely or all sorts of crazy stuff? And they said, well, like we want to give you an opportunity to prepare and it wouldn't be fair otherwise. Why I gotta prepare? Why does this have to be – why does it even need to be like treated as like, oh, like these are established formats that we're seeing people play? You could have gone bonkers, and what am I going to – like what are the 30 people involved or the 28 people involved going to say? No, I don't like this tournament. I'm not going now. Like, oh, I couldn't draft enough cube in time. Like they're going to show up and do their best. So – I think that one thing that would have been useful is just making it apparent that this is a special one-time thing, that this – or like this is not even parallel to the pro Magic scene and everything. This is an independent like kickoff to our esport aspirations and initiative. It's held at a convention. This is not your normal Magic event. Now, it's a lot easier to say that if people aren't looking for every little grain of rice of information, and if this happens, they're going to extrapolate that everything's going to be like this and we're screwed and you're going to have to know somebody in WotC or be a streamer and I'll never even know how I'm going to get chosen as a streamer because they're using criteria that we don't know about. Like people complain all the time about the college football playoff. Like this is the same thing to some people. And yeah, like when the Saints get screwed or Clemson gets not whatever team gets Utah gets screwed, then people complain because there isn't a transparent process, or they have an argument for why they should be in and somebody else doesn't. Same thing with MVP in the NBA. So basically, like, they just need to be a little bit more transparent, and it cuts off a lot of arguments.
I think some more transparency definitely would be helpful. No doubt. I think that's one of the biggest complaints about Wizards of the Coast, but has been for a decade. And trust me, I rip them to shreds about that all the time. So
they could also say, you know what? So-and-so who thinks that they should have been in for this tournament, you know what? You have every right to think that you are in that you should have been in this tournament. But guess what? There's going to be another tournament in 6 months, and another tournament after that. And it's totally possible you'll be in one of those, because we're not just making this the end all be all. And it's not like you're cut out.
That would also be nice, assuming there's truth to that, you know, assuming there's some validity there.
At this rate, I don't even know if there needs to be a ton of truth to it. Just freaking say something. Like, enough things have happened. Like, because then maybe that's the truth at that time, and we're just doing our best here.
Yeah, well, you know, I'm always very fond of saying nothing is saying something, you know?
Yeah, and like, I get that there's the, we'd rather ask for forgiveness than ask for permission, but like, no, like, we can't hold Wizards to anything, so like, they should, I don't know, just say something that's a little bit more – basically say something so that people can't fill in their own ideas, because their own ideas are actually going to be worse than not the truth.
A million times worse. Every time. Every time.
Yeah. And then again, like, even something like – so I'm not going to delve super deep into issues of like, okay, like this streamer I don't like, or this pro has a checkered past, or all sorts of different things. But like, they could have also just said, we intentionally selected invitees with the aim of having a diverse and inclusive field, and we expect people to be on their best behavior. Done. And then you know what that gives you license to do as the company? Anything. And then if somebody's left out, that's because they haven't even said we're choosing people because we want to. If they just say that, well, then what are you going to say? You chose the wrong person?
Okay, well, I mean, that's a matter of opinion.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, and so, like, I mean, obviously that flies a little bit more, like, for certain events than for others, but, like, the problem is that, like there's a way that they could have done the Silver Showcase in a way – well, they could have done the Silver Showcase in a way that would make it more palatable and successful as it happened. Here, I have no doubt that the event is going to be freaking awesome. They just haven't – they haven't told us it's coming up in a way that allows people to really be that optimistic, because there's all these other questions about it.
Unless you're qualified.
They just said, we're showing off the full gamut of pros and casual players and streamers and stock decks plus innovation and everything. And it's going to show off all the best stuff that this game has to offer. And we're just handpicking everything to show the world that doesn't know Magic how great this game can be. Done. Is someone going to say, no, you shouldn't do that? That's a terrible metric. You should only pick the highest pro points. You know what? The number 64 in pro points is more important than having diversity. Like, they can say that. I just won't listen to them. Like, the world.
Yeah, I mean, people can say whatever they want. Yeah. But yeah, I wouldn't listen to them or agree with them either.
Yeah, just say, like, this is our circus and we're running it this way, as opposed to saying, like, these are the rules of the circus. Well, but you're holding them and you're not showing me them. What does it say on there? Like, well, they're the rules.
Yeah, that's legit. I again, the lack of transparency is incredibly frustrating. And I agree with you. And, you know, I'll say this in my own words, basically. If they just said, hey, we're picking X influencers because this is how we want to do it, deal with it. You know, that would be better than people going like, well, why didn't Jeff Hogan get in? Or why didn't Caleb or Jim Davis get in? And, you know, various other things. And why is this person in it or not? And why are there so many women? Which, you know, by the way, why not have so many women? Honestly, I don't understand people's beef with that.
Yeah, I mean, the Ruth Bader Ginsburg, Sandra Day O'Connor. The fact that I'm mixing up probably makes me really insensitive. But she was asked, what's the right number of women to have on the Supreme Court? And she said 9. And the person was shocked. And she's like, well, no one's shocked when there's 9 men. So, yeah, like, I mean, you don't need an all-women tournament. But you also don't need an all men tournament ever. So
yeah, why not? I mean, obviously agree. we are in lockstep there.
You're probably just saying obviously agree because it says so in your contract that you signed with Wizards.
In my signed contract for Wizards of the Coast. You know me. If there's anything, you know me. I'm not one willing to speak my mind about things. I don't do that.
Well, I mean you're reading that verbatim off of the contract.
I have it printed off. Can you hear this paper? I have it printed off right there. There it is.
Well, see that's the problem, and I guess it doesn't apply as much to you as it does for basically the MPL players. I don't know. Like Seth Manfield was talking about, like, man, I played some insane games of Standard today. This was awesome, and I just told him, like, oh, you're paid to say that, aren't you? And then he's like, what? No. Like, and even if I was, I can still say how I feel. And it's like, oh, you're just reading that off the cue card. Me chill. And well, there are some people who are taking that tack where it's like, oh, you like the game of Magic? Yeah, hashtag sponsored. You're saying that because you're paid to like it. Well, I'm actually paid now because I liked it so much that maybe to the exclusion of other things that I should have liked more, but here I am. This is actually success. And yeah, so probably don't need to be that negative as far as the whole cue cards thing. But yeah, like if you're going to get someone to tell people that things are going to be okay, make it like somebody involved in making the decision, not somebody who's as affected as you are. So like, yeah, like I wouldn't be super envious of the people in that league right now, as far as the communication situation that they're in. I mean, I'm glad that they're able to play pro Magic. And I think a lot of people rightfully should be envious of the situation that they're in, the same way that I'm envious of someone who wins a tournament because I want to win a tournament. But yeah, that's not – I mean, also it doesn't help them to say that this is good because it's like, well, yeah, oh, yeah, it's good for you. Yeah. And it's like, no, it's good in general. Oh, it's good in general for you?
Yeah. Tell me more. Tell me more.
Yeah, tell me more about how the things that affect me actually are fine because of how they've affected you. Like, so that's – yeah, I mean, really, I don't want to say that to you, but mainly because I – like – yeah, I mean, it's tough because you have to keep maybe you're incentivized to keep a low profile while you're also supposed to be representing all that's good in Magic.
Hey, Tommy, I just wanted to let you know that this Mythic Arena tournament I'm playing in is really good for me. It's super good for me.
You know, you're probably saying that it's good for you because you're paid to – well.
That's right.
Actually, not because you're paid to say that, because you're paid and because it's actually good for you.
Hashtag sponsored. Say it with me. Yeah, I mean,
technically, like the whole hashtag sponsored, hashtag ad thing – is because of people saying, man, you know what? Makeup's really great, as they've got like their hand behind them holding cash.
Yeah.
That they were given.
That's that's an actual legal thing that you have to do with the hashtag sponsored.
Yeah. And I mean, people pay for ads and they're paying for ads right now. And hypothetically, yeah, like I love you, Seth, but the stuff that you're saying is, I mean, it may not be an ad, but you might be angrier. Like you might criticize Wizards if you hadn't – I mean, if I'm freaking Seth, I'm criticizing Wizards if I'm not in the MPL. So that's for freaking sure. But – and I don't want to pick on him. But basically, yeah, like it's tough because these people who are supposed to be the faces of Magic are also not negatively affected at a time when other people are negatively affected. And it's tough – or potentially negatively affected. We don't even know. And so it's tough to then figure out like, okay, well, so what do you say? And shit, I mean, saying nothing might not even be that's not in their personal interest. Like they're supposed to be in the limelight.
Yeah. I mean, that's kind of the goal in the job, but unfortunately.
You lose either way.
That's true. And unfortunately I got to go, dude. I got to get out of here. But this will this will not be the last time I have you on, because when I have more times, we could go for 90 minutes or 2 hours easy and just talk about
things. Yeah. I know you've got a lot of testing to do for best of 2.5 or
best
whatever
of,
it is.
Best of fun is what I call it. We'll talk about that format. And also, we got to talk about you helping me get ready for that tournament, because that's your responsibility now.
I will happily teach you the take back rules on Arena.
He is Tommy Ashton. He is Stainerson on Magic Online. I hope you don't play against him because you'll probably lose. And
yeah,
I will stop. You rarely lose.
Quantity, man. Like everything in life, quantity.
Ah, right. Not quality, quantity.
Yeah.
Okay. Is that a thing people say? I don't know. I'll have you on again sometime. But for now, I got to run out the door and get some more work done after I get back. So he's Tommy. I'm Cedric. Thanks for listening. Congratulations on your 14-1 finish with your Stupid Grixis deck. We're out of here. Well, unfortunately, I had to rush out the door last night. I'm recording this outro here on a snowy Monday afternoon in Seattle, Washington. Yes, Seattle gets snow. I decided to get in the car and drive around a little bit to run some errands. That was probably not the smartest idea because Seattle doesn't really have snowplows or salt. So it was a little dangerous, I guess we'll say, but I made it back alive and I'm not leaving the house again for the rest of the day. I don't know how long this is going to stick for. It is a little bit interesting because snow in Seattle is it's just a catastrophe. No one's going to work today at all. Everyone's just staying home and it's only like 3 or 4 inches. I'm from Ohio. Tommy lives in DC. This is nothing for us, but here I am in Seattle and like the entire city is shut down. So it goes, I guess. But I had to put a quick close to that podcast, unfortunately, but I do plan on having Tommy back on because, first of all, he's one of my best friends in the entire world, but second of all, that dude is really fucking smart, right? He's really well-spoken and super smart. He's a lot of fun to talk to. That's one of many reasons, excuse me, why we're such good friends. We have some very honest conversations between each other, and we've developed a great friendship over the years. And I am very proud to call him one of my best friends in the world, and he's actually going to be hanging out with me at Magic Fest and Mythic Championship Cleveland. He's staying with me and my parents. My parents meet him for the first time. It'll be great, because he's great, and everything's great. If you liked what you heard, and I hope you did, you can find the Cedric Phillips podcast on SoundCloud, Stitcher, Spotify, iTunes, the podcast app, and over on Patreon at patreon.com/thecedricphillipspodcast, where you can become a patron and get yourself some Ultimate Guard sleeves. You can get some Cedric Phillips tokens, access to a special Discord, and a whole bunch of other things as well. Let's see. Of course, subscribe, rate, and review the podcast. If you liked what you heard, you can do that over on iTunes. Positive, negative, 1-star, 5-star, somewhere in between. Do whatever you'd like. And yeah, like I said, I'm going to Dallas to do a little coverage action with P. Sully, Ryan Overturf, Todd Anderson, Nick Miller, the rest of the SCG Tour crew. Should have not a Royal Rumble podcast, but another wrestling podcast with Joey Bags later in the week where we'll talk wrestling and nonsense. And it looks like a NBA trade deadline podcast as well, for those of you who care about such things. So, as usual, thanks for listening. Jules Vera, take me home.